Danke. So, hi everyone. Tonight, Stefan and I are gonna talk about how to organize a CTF. And we'll start with a short intro about what a CTF is and why you should organize one yourself. Then we're gonna talk about what kinds of CTF exist and where the differences are. Then we'll go into the things you need, you should do, and you probably shouldn't do during the organization. So it's basically just a lesson learned from us. And finally, there will be a Q&A session where you can ask your own questions. Okay, let's start. First, a short introduction about who we are. Stefan and me are members of the Square Roots, which is the official CTF team of University of Mannheim. And we as a group started participating CTF around 2006. And right now we organize two public CTFs, and we also organize a workshop each year where we'll have two newbie CTFs. So we'll want to teach new interested students in the topic, and thereby we organize a newbie CTF. So you might wonder about the name Square Roots. The name comes basically from the city where we come from. It's Mannheim. It's also called Quadratestadt in German, so square city. And so we took the square, and then we took the root from Linux. You probably know about what root is, or the process of rooting. And if you mix it together, you have square roots. So, what is a CTF? CTF stands for Capture the Flag, and is basically an information security competition. So the goal is to get as many flags as possible. Flags are just a sort of string, which you can see here, and you get them for solving challenges, and you can redeem them at the game server for points for your team. So basically the goal is to get as many flags as possible and thereby get as many points as possible. And talking about CTFs, there are three big kinds of CTFs. First is the challenge-based, server-based, and mixed. The challenge-based CTF usually contains challenges all over InfoSec. So you have reversing challenges where you have, for example, to reverse engineer an key generation algorithm. You have trivia challenges where you have to find things in the internet. For example, a recent challenge was to find the account number from the bad guy from the Hackers movie. And you have crypto challenges where you have to break crypto algorithms, and programming challenges where you have to gorilla program, so you have to code something that solves a code, and so on. So just like I said before, each solved challenge gives you a flag, and basically you have those different categories and you just solve them on your own or in a team. When we talk about challenge-based CTFs, they usually take several days. And some big examples are DEFCON CTF, which is one of the world famous CTFs, I think, or the Plate CTF. When you participate at a CTF, the scoreboard usually looks like this. So you have those different categories, and you have challenges. And the more difficult the challenges are, the more points you get. OK. Then there are the server-based CTFs, where the basic principle is that you have to fight the other teams and at the same time protect your own team or your infrastructure. Basically, it works like this. You have a network. Either you are physically at on-site, or you participate over VPN. And each team has the same VM image. And so also the same vulnerabilities and so on. And then you try to find the vulnerabilities in your own image and write exploits and exploit the other teams. This usually takes some hours because, yeah, you have to be in the event all the time. You can or it would be bad if you say, for example, yeah, I go sleep some hours because, then you would lose a lot of time. Some big examples also here are rootCTF and iCTF. I just have another overview in order to show you the how it works in detail. So just you have those different teams. Let's assume you are team one. And during the CTF, the game server starts submitting team-specific and service-specific flags. So the teams, the game server pushes those flags, those strings, into each of the vulnerable boxes. He does this by methods which are programmed into the challenges. So for example, if you have a vulnerable service like a web application where users can send messages, and the vulnerability would be, for example, SQL injection. And in this case, the gaming server could push flags by just simulating a user sending some messages to other users. So you have the flags on all of those machines, and you go to your own, look at your own VM, find the vulnerabilities, fix them in your own system, write exploits, and basically get the flags from all other systems, and then you just submit them to the game server and get points. Yeah, this is scoreboard from one of our recent CTFs. You can see there are the different teams, and there are offensive points for which you get for attacking other teams, and there are defensive points which you get for example, fixing a service, and yeah. And then you also have per service status overview, because the game server, when he pushes the flags, he also checks if the service is intact, if it works, if it behaves just like he should. And if it doesn't, you also might get some points subtracted, because otherwise you just could stop your service, then nobody could attack you. But on the other side, this would be very unfair for the other teams. So this is punished by subtracting points from you. Yeah, and the last category is the mixed CTF, where you usually have a central infrastructure. Usually they are on site. So you meet with all of the teams in one big area, and then you get access to an unknown network, and you have to find your way through the network. So Nmap is your friend. What you usually first do is you scan, check what services are running, and for example, the second round could be that you have to solve a forensic challenge or something like that. And usually the third round is something like the King of the Hill challenge, where you have to get access to one server and have to defend your root shell from the other teams, because the other teams, all teams, are gonna try to get access to this one server, and if you have root access, you have to defend it so no other team can gain root privileges also. One example for this kind of CTF is the Packet War CTF. Okay. Now you all know what the CTF is, and now Stefan will continue telling you why you should organize CTF and some other details.
Yeah, so that's the very content of our presentation today. So why should you organize a CTF in the first place, not just take part in one? And the idea is to like implement your own ideas you have, you maybe have for challenges. So that was, I think, the most drive we got for our first own CTF, because we have played so much CTFs. We had like a good idea of what we, how a CTF should look like and like what to do. And so we just tried that. Also, you, it gains you very much knowledge about like, about how CTFs work and stuff. So what's really behind that? Also, you can challenge yourself, like to really do something that big, like get it running and keep it good for all the players. And that's a very good incentive. Also, you can improve communication and collaboration with other teams. The idea behind this is there are not that many CTF teams out there, and you probably get many of them to take part in your CTF, and that really connects with them. So we had many teams come to us and like say, yeah, nice, you also did one, and also had like input, what should we do better and what was good and that stuff. Also, it's like really important to contribute back to the community. So we did our CTFs at Gulasch Programmiernacht in Karlsruhe. And we think it's like a really, really good addition to such a venue and to have like a CTF there, and people really enjoyed it. That's that's really cool stuff. And also it's fun. It's fun to do it. It's a lot of work, but it's fun nonetheless. So what goes into a CTF? Most and for all, commitment and time. So making a CTF really takes time and really takes commitment to get stuff done, to keep playing the ball, to like look into all the little stuff you have to handle. Obviously, there you have to make challenges, because that's the main idea of playing a CTF, to like do challenges. You have to have workforce, so like people that do stuff. You probably don't want to do that alone. Also, you have to have infrastructure, like scoreboard, where you can, other players can see what their score is, how they compare to the other teams. You have to have servers where all the challenges run on, and you have network stuff to do. To get more specific about that point, you want your challenges to be versatile. So we had people approaching us after our first CTFs, and they said, well, the first one was a challenge-based CTF, and the second one was a server-based CTF, and they really said, oh, we didn't like the server-based because the kind of challenges they were not that cool, and I'm not interested in that stuff, and yeah, we really can understand that, and you should be as versatile as possible to like get as much people to join you as possible. Also, you want to be unpredictable. As an experienced CTF player, I really can say you, if you have like multiple challenges and they like there's a scheme behind that you can repeat to get to fix the challenges, that's not something you want to have. You want to surprise the players. You want your players to like really get into stuff, to like not be obvious about the solution. You want to be precise in how you like present a challenge. You really want to tell the players how they should approach the challenge and what is the target and what is not. Probably your infrastructure, for example, is not. DDoSing your infrastructure will like is not that challenge. You want to have rules and enforce them. That's also very important because there are some stuff that players can do and probably will do if you do not say they shouldn't do, because they can and they like DDoS your servers, or they will delete flags from other teams. We also had that, and that's really not cool. That like reduces the fun for everyone, and they should also enforce the rules by checking the network and stuff. Infrastructure. So no CTF without infrastructure. You have to keep in mind your network is attacked, or the attacks come from within your network. So You should really expect the unexpected. You really should think about what an attacker can do and what we will do. You probably get that experience if you played some CTFs yourself. You like learn how to think like an attacker. And yeah, you really want to contain the attack. So if somebody breaks your service, like they should do, and they have a shell or something, you don't want them to like have really network access or drop their 0 days to get root access or stuff. So keep your stuff patched, for example. Scoreboards. So the really idea behind CTFs is like to have a competition between teams and players. And you really want to do that with a scoreboard, like a list with all the teams and how much points they have, so like they can see how good they are and how they are progressing with their points. There's like a prepared server for that that's called CTFD that you can use for Jeopardy-style CTFs. So like you just only have to implement your challenges and you're ready. Also, you want to have backup systems ready. So if something breaks and stuff will break, you can switch that. Some quick do's and don'ts. You want to start early because that's, like I said, it's really much work to do and it takes planning and preparation and stuff. And yeah, you want to speak with your local on-site orga if you're like doing an on-site CTF. Like they provide you with network and power and stuff, that everything is ready when you start. And you know, you don't have to care about that yourself. A schedule typically looks like this. So you have a start of planning phase, like 6 months before the actual date. They like think about challenges, implement stuff, and yeah, build infrastructure. Then you have like a final test of the setup. That's very important because most of the time stuff don't work at the first time. And then there's, for server-based CTF, there's a team test network stuff going on. So if teams are using VPNs to dial into you, you want to test that before. So you have like a debug VM ready for them to test, just connecting to your network that you, everybody knows the network is correct and everything is ready. And you can really concentrate on the CTF and not care about the infrastructure. Keep it simple. So debugging is much easier if stuff is simple. We had incidents with our CTFs. We used new technology and based everything on that. And yeah, as it turns out, the Docker we used was not that stable as we thought. And yeah, server broke down minutes. And yeah, we have to change the setup while everything was running, and that's a whole mess. You don't want to do that. And also, multi-stage challenges can be frustrating. So the simple idea in this regard is keep the challenges simple. You want people to like do the challenge and not really want the people to have to figure out every time like what to do. And yeah, just keep it simple, make a single stage, so no connection between, I found that solution and now I need to use that and do another challenge with it. So yeah, organize a team. So as I said, it takes much time. You want to have a team and you want to have it organized. That's maybe obvious, but that's something you should really think about when start planning stuff. And you want to have people at the site when the CTF is running, because if something breaks down, you don't want to have just one guy being on it and everything else is unprotected and stuff. Yeah, and test. That's very important. You want to check your challenges for vulnerabilities. So the vulnerabilities, not the challenge itself. We had several times when there was another vulnerability in the server or something that's not part of the challenge, but people will try to abuse that stuff. So you really want to check in with that and see that it's fixed. Yeah, you want to have somebody else run through your challenges. You as a developer, like have another view on it. You created the challenge. You know what you have to do to get the flag. but you just want to have someone else not taking part in the organization to test the challenge. Also test your setup, as I said, stuff will break down, and you should really think like an attacker in this regard. Refrain from last second challenges. So the thing is, if you do like a day before or hours before the CTF is starting and like, oh, I have another idea, I want to implement that, that really doesn't work out most of the time. Your stuff is probably not tested, and most probably your team does not know about the changes. So when something breaks down and something is to be fixed, and not everybody knows about the changes you make, you have really a problem, get stuff ready again. Yeah, the last point is getting publicity. So if you do a CTF, it's really only cool if you have enough players taking part. So spread the word among other teams. Most of the teams really like to take part in other teams' CTFs, so that's really cool. There's a site for where you can post your CTF, and that's really, everybody knows that site who's doing CTFs, and they really check in often with that site to see if there's new announcements. And on-site, you maybe want to get attention with talks or something, because you have, if you do Jeopardy style or something, there are really many players that just don't know about first, but get in last second. And as a really last point, as a small reminder, we have a CTF here at the camp, and that's organized by Svetlana Ahura, another really famous CTF team. And it just started, like I think about 6 o'clock. And it's really for beginners. So if you like what you just heard, so really want to look into that. Yeah, and that was it. We are ready for questions.
We now have about 7 minutes for questions. There's one mic over there and one mic over there, so just cue at the mics if you want to ask a question. I'll just talk to you and then you can speak. Anybody? Okay, this one to the right.
Thanks for the talk and the inspiration. I have a question on tool sets or frameworks that might be available to assist in the creation of the CTF. Like you mentioned, the scoreboard kind of thing. Are there other tools for rolling out the tokens, etc., that might help creating something like that?
Well, most of the time stuff is really homebrew, so teams create their stuff themselves most of the time. And yeah, that's the only like available technology that we know about that you can, that's ready for use for you.
Yeah, I think I heard about another tool. I'm not sure about the name. I just read about it, which is specially for server-based CTFs. So they have technologies like VirtualBox, and they you have your challenges or your file system layout for the VM or for the Woolenbox VM, which every participant gets, and with one click, you can generate all participant VMs, and it will all automatically create a unique team Woolenbox VM, inject the VPN credentials, and all this kind of stuff. But I'm not sure about the name anymore, unfortunately.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Left, please.
Hello. Semi-answer to the previous question, Legitimate Business Syndicate open source their previous CTF tools. But actual question, what's your favorite category of CTF challenges, either to solve or to build?
Well, I think everybody has his personal like preference. I like personally like very much programming stuff because I tend to have less time for programming myself, so that's really something I'd like to do.
My personal favorite category is web, probably because Gerrit's generally more CTF team which is web focused, but yeah, just like Stefan said, I think everyone in our team has his or her favorite category.
Just curious. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Is it a question? Yes, it is.
Yes, hello. What's the size of a CTF team? So how many people are in a normal team?
Well, that tends to vary. Also, like if you're doing a challenge-based or server-based, but and how well organized you are. Our team, for example, is like 20 players at max with the really important CTFs, but can go down to like 5 people or 3 even for smaller ones. So also there, I know of people that like are alone and taking part alone and are like really successful with that. But yeah.
Mm. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, another point, I just like Stefan said, it depends very on server-based and challenge-based. I only can say it with how it is for us. When we have a server-based CTF, usually server-based CTFs are nowadays very rare. But when there is a server-based CTF, usually our computer lab at the university is full with 30 people, and otherwise the challenge-based CTFs, they aren't so populated because maybe also they ask very often, and yeah.
Left mic, please.
This is another answer to the question before about what resources are there. The one you may have been thinking of is CTFD, which is described as CTF in a can. Just check it out, ctfd.io gives you all the infrastructure and resources. The question I have is, what's the first flag for the camp CTF? The flag for the camp CTF?
Yeah.
Can you tell us the answer?
No, probably we shouldn't do that because it would destroy the fun for all of us.
No, it's okay. Thank you.
Nice try.
The right mic, please.
I'm actually interested in creating CTFs for people who are interested in beginning their journey with technology. And may not have a really in-depth knowledge of some of the tech that they're using right now. Do you have any suggestions for how to limit the focus of your challenges around that sort of goal?
Well, most of the time, like the trivia challenges are really like for people not into the technology stuff that much. But it really depends on what you want to achieve. There are like challenges. Possible changes for every like progression into that stuff. So,
okay, now we are almost out of time. Is there one last question? Okay, go ahead.
You told us that there's a few software about helping for creating CTFs, and you told us that you have a bunch of software on your computer. Do you thought of releasing it?
Well, I know of teams that do like open source their stuff, and that's really cool, but it's most of the time not ready for use. You can't just take it and do your CTF or use it in taking part of a CTF. And yeah, our own stuff, well, the thing is, if you're doing server-based CTFs, your like success chance really depends on how much infrastructure and code you have on your hands to do that, and well, you can imagine that it's unfortunate that we can't open source our stuff because other teams tend to use it, and that probably limits our success in CTFs.
No, I was only talking about the scripts to create CTFs.
I think he meant the organ.
I think we started to open source the challenges we had and something about their infrastructure to deploy it, and yeah, so most some teams do that, some organizers do that. Yeah, so but it's not really ready for use because our time is limited, and commitment tend to go down after the CTF, so nobody likes to like clean up the code and stuff. So
But if you are interested, for example, in our challenges, just go to our GitHub page and look up of first CTF, for example, and then you find all the server side source code and
Okay, please thank our speakers once again.